So for this STI etch, I want to point two things. One is the aspect ratio of this etch. So we etch into this silicon using nitride as the hard mark. So if we look at the FIS STI feature, it has this silicon, and then we have used nitride as a hard mask. And the aspect ratios which are involved in this etch are typically of they can be of more than 10:1. That is, this height of the etch can be more than 10 times the width. So this S, or this shallow in this shallow trench isolation, is really a misnomer, because it's quite deep if you look at the aspect ratio. And the other thing is the chemistry. So this we use a dry or a plasma based chemistry for this STI, and the typical chemistry used for silicon etch is you use a chlorine based chemistry. So your silicon reacts with this chlorine ions, and it forms SiClx, which is essentially a volatile compound, and it goes away. It goes away from this trench, and that's why you're able to continue to etch and make this feature. So the next thing you do after you have made this STI feature is now you need to etch it. Sorry, you need to fill it. So the next step is to fill this trench with an oxide. So again, the main challenge now again is that you have a very high aspect ratio feature to fill. So you have this trench with an aspect ratio of more than 10:1. So we use either a plasma based or a very high density plasma to fill up this shallow trench isolation. And then the next step after that is the CMP step. So once you have filled up your STI, that fill overflow, then you get this kind of a profile, and then you want to level everything back. So you want to level everything back into a flat surface. So the step that is used for that is the chemical mechanical polishing, and it's depicted over here. And so this cartoon over here, it shows the CMP equipment, and it's essentially the same equipment that you use for any kind of polishing. So it involves this rotating table which is made of an abrasive material, and then you mount your wafer to this carrier, and then you spin this carrier again, and you apply a downward force, and then you keep on flowing this slurry. So the surface is wet with the slurry, and then you keep on rotating this wafer, and depending upon how much downward pressure you apply, you polish your surface. Shown here is a picture showing one of the CMP tools. So we can identify this table over here, and we can see this wafer carrier, and the wafer is probably attached below this carrier, and there'll be also slurry on the surface. So the surface would be wet with the slurry. The chemistry of the slurry is also very important. Depending upon what material we are trying to polish, we'll use a different slurry. But it in principle it looks like any other polishing tool, like a tool that you would use to polish your knives. It looks, the operating principle is the same, and it's a very unique tool. If you go in a fab, this is probably the tool which would be making most of this noise. So it's make this squeaky kind of a noise, and it produces a very signature defect pattern as well. So if you have a wafer and you get a particle over here in your CMP, so the defect pattern that it produces, because everything is rotating over here, so you have this table rotating and you have your wafer rotating, so that defect also produces like a rotating key kind of a pattern. So it's a This technology was pioneered really by IBM in the last decade, and now it's used very pervasively in the industry. So what you get after you do your CMP, after you do your chemical mechanical polishing, you get a very flat surface. And so you get this flat surface with your silicon, and then you have this oxide filled in this trench. So shown here is a TM image showing this shame. So we started with this nitride as a hard mask, and we etched this STI feature into our silicon. Then we filled it up with the oxide, and then you do a CMP. So you have now again back this flat surface, and your oxide is filled in this feature. So now that we are done with STI, the next step in the process flow is to form these weld implants. So these weld implants, they define essentially your active region. So by active region, this mean that the regions where the devices would be made. So you define where will you make your P-channel device, and you define where you'll make your N-channel device. What you do is essentially you again pattern your resist, and you just expose the region where you want to say make P-channel devices. So these are PMOS devices, or they have essentially a N-type substrate. So then you implant this region with say arsenic or phosphorus, and so you create this N well, and then you do then you use another layer of resist, and you expose the region where you want to maybe make your NMOS devices. So you want to make your N channel devices over here, so you need a P-type substrate. So you implant this with the boron, and once you are done implanting, you do activation anneal to activate these dopants. The next set of process steps involve the formation of the gate stack. So the first thing that we need to form to make a gate is the gate insulator, or the gate dielectric. And the way it's done is that you oxidize your silicon. So it's a thermally grown oxide, and you grow this silicon oxide on the active area, on all the area where your silicon is exposed. And then you cover it up with a poly. So you do a blanket deposition of polysilicon, and you cover this whole wafer with the polysilicon. And the next step then is to pattern this polysilicon into the gate lines. So we cover it up with a hard mask. So you have this poly, then you put a hard mask, then you put photoresist, then you pattern that photoresist to form these gate lines, and to form this gate pattern. And then you etch that gate pattern into your polysilicon. So you etch your poly material to form these set of gate lines. So now you have these gate lines. These are gate lines, let's say, to P types of devices. And then these are gate lines which are connecting to N-channel devices. And if you come and take an aerial picture of your chip, it would look something like this. So it would remember I had shown this picture to describe the SRAM cell, where I had shown you the different transistors. So it was taken at this point of time in your process flow, where you have just defined your gate stack, so you can where you had just defined your gate line, so you can see these gate lines. Some of these gate lines would be running on let's say P-channel transistors, and The rest of them, you know, the next few would be running on, say, n-channel transistors. And now you can see that you can probably start identifying transistors at this point of time. So remember earlier we identified these two transistors, one being n-type and one being p-type, whose gates are connected, so they form an inverter. And this was connected to this other inverter, which was formed by these set of transistors. Again, one being p-type, another being n-type, and they were essentially cross-connected. So you can now see your skeleton of your SRAM cell taking into shape over here.